All right, we will start this meeting, May 9th, first meeting in May of two, and we'll start with the Pledge of Allegiance.
Of the United States of America, and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Okay, roll call when ready.
Okay, Mr. Westerbarth, absent. Ms. McGuire?
Here.
Mr. Cummings?
Here.
Mr. Gajewski?
Here.
Ms. Prasco, here. Mr. Weed is absent. Mr. Byer?
Here.
Thank you. Agenda additions. Bob, you first.
We have one potential agenda addition involving the lease for the parking lot adjoining this building.
Okay. And with the board's okay, under other, we will make that item number four. There already are three in that category. Anyone else have anything regarding the agenda? I have a couple things, but you guys first. Anybody? Okay. One is have a resignation that we need to look at, and I would like to make that number five under other. And number six under other, I attended a meeting of the Iosco County Road Commission this morning at 10 o'clock, along with some very, very interested residents of Alexander Road. And there's some things I'd like to share with the board. I think some of you are familiar with Alexander Road, and if you're not, I would ask you to make yourself familiar with Alexander Road in the next week or two. So, but we'll get to that at the end. So, I think that's it. So we have three additions. Okay. Next is public hearing.
Nope.
No?
Public comment.
No, I have public hearing on what was given to me.
Oh, we don't have a public hearing.
All right. It's one I copied from yours today. It says public hearing.
There's a spot for a public hearing.
Yeah, there's just no title in there.
All right.
Right.
Okay. Don't mess with the robot.
Right.
Public comment.
Yes.
You have some cards. Before we get into that, mention again that we ask that you fill out a card indicating what your concerns are, what your questions are, and each person has 4 minutes to speak.
We have one card from Richard Miller who would like to talk about survey issues regarding court order.
Okay. Dick?
So they can hear you.
First off, I'd like to read again the letter that I wrote to Township Board here November 9th, 2015, if I may, and then I'd like to give a copy of it to the board to keep with respect to this.
You just don't want to eat up your 4 minutes.
So. No.
Okay.
To Oscoda Township Board members, because of ongoing and unresolved issues regarding property boundaries and litigation attempting to resolve them, I think it important that you understand my commitment to my profession, being a professional land surveyor, that who and what I am is important. Number one, what's right is right, what's wrong is wrong, and in most cases, it doesn't take a genius to know the difference. Number two, it's not what you know, it's who you know. Number three, why don't people just do their jobs? Number four, it's incredible what money will buy. Number five, this is most important. Every person should be held accountable for the choices they make. These personal philosophies are based on my 55-plus years of practicing my profession as a land surveyor, which I absolutely love doing and just living my life. My practice has always been governed by the fact that no client will tell me what to do, nor no client attorney will tell me what to do. And with respect to the legal system, a court of law determination will dictate what I do. However, it has been my experience that determinations are so often made without the presiding judge being provided the necessary information from which to make a proper determination. And with that comment, I will continue to do what is right. Respectfully, me, Richard Miller. P.S. I will be available to any person who wishes any further communication and or clarification regarding any ongoing issue in Oscoda Township. Now, with respect to that, Mr. Byer, just before I left for Arizona last November, indicated he had some concerns about the issue out on Bowden Road. Is that correct?
Yeah, we talked about a lot of things. That might have been one of them.
Oh, that was one of them. But since then, I became aware of a letter that Al Grasser wrote to Judge Bergeron, who was the presiding judge in that case. And I'd like to indicate what was ruled in that court case. The bottom line, which, well, I, like I say, I got a copy of the letter that the Al Grasser written, and he highlighted information on the court order. The last statement in the order highlighted, it is hereby further ordered and adjudged that this public roadway shall be totally under and within the jurisdiction of the Charter Township of Oscoda. The remaining portion of the roadway contiguous to the parcel of property owned by Thomas and Emily Bowden, not utilized by the roadway contiguous to it, shall thereafter be owned by defendants Thomas and Emily Bowden, and as identified in the survey to be performed by surveyor Richard Miller. I was not apprised of that case, but I certainly have all the survey evidence because the township hired me initially to identify everything that existed out there, which I did. And I would like to quickly show you information. This here is from the U.S. Forest Service identifying roads. Specifically identified and specifically identified whether they were surveyed or not. The issue out there is section line roads. This property is bounded by section lines. Mm-hmm. And in that regard, a section line road is 66 feet in width, 33 feet either side of the section line. My survey, which I would like to show, which was not presented, my job as a surveyor is to identify what physically exists on the ground with respect to titles and legal descriptions. Chris was aware of the results of the effort that I made. Our police chief assisted me in identifying everything that was out there by taking several photographs, identifying the magnitude of the obstructions constructed in that right-of-way. So my issue, or my concern, is that final order that the judge signed. So I wanted to bring that to the township board's attention. I am currently retired. I elected to not renew my license, but these survey documents are dated back 2013, so they still apply. So does anyone have any questions regarding this issue?
Well,
have I gone over my minutes?
Yes, oh. But that's okay. What would you have us do? I mean, What are the taxpayers of Oscoda Township supposed to do about your concerns?
Well, my concerns are the court order has not been abided by.
Okay.
I have the information that the court says I must provide. I was not apprised of the court hearing. But I documented everything before that. Subsequent to my survey, the township attorney requested from Mr. Rigg a survey identifying property issues, which I refused to do because it violated every principle of my profession.
Okay.
So my position is the court order is specific, and I believe it should be dealt with.
So if you are that concerned, should you contact the court? I know Judge Bergeron has retired, but if it's your concern, should you not pursue this in the court?
Well, it's a court order. You know, I would think that the township, being you are the plaintiff, would pursue the fulfillment of the court order. That's my belief.
Well,
as far as my involvement is concerned, it won't cost you one nickel for any further testimony. I am obsessed. What's right is right.
Okay. Well, I think would the board agree that we should talk to our attorney about that?
I think that's a great idea.
So we will do that.
I appreciate that. Thank you.
Sure.
You want me to leave this letter with Bob, the copy of what I just read to you?
Sure.
Okay.
Yes.
I don't want to lose it.
Okay.
Thanks, Bob.
Thank you.
By the way, Mr. Stalker has a copy of that letter with all this information if you want to read
and so,
that.
And so do we.
Oh, okay. Thank you for your time.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you. Do we have other cards?
We do not.
Okay. All right, then. Then we'll move on to the consent agenda. First item, of course, is the minutes from the April 25th meeting. Anybody have any comments or questions on those? Hearing none. Financial report. The last 2 weeks, payment of bills to the tune of $183,952.92. Is there anybody who has a question about any of those? As I so have often commented that those bills are gone over with a fine-tooth comb on the morning of our meetings by the clerk and the treasurer and the township superintendent. So, hearing none. Informational reports, we have three by Mr. Stalker, and that would be it tonight. Water filling station locations. I kind of think that's important enough that the water filling station. Bob, you want to go over that and how people become legal to get water and so forth, where they should go and that type of thing, just real quickly.
Sure.
Because we've changed the location.
Yes. Based on the closure of the community center, we've moved the filling station during the weekdays to location on the back of the Township Hall building. There's signage. Folks who have a voucher from District Health Department number 2, that's what essentially provides eligibility to access the water, would check in the police department. The voucher number would be written down, a record of how much water they're going to take, and then they'll be given a key and they can access that faucet at this point. During the weekend, we'll make the water available at Old Orchard Park, and similar situation, except that they would check in the registration office at the park.
At the park?
Yes.
Okay. And the containers for the water, they can either get from the District Health Department in Tawas, is that right? Or Rogers?
Well, I don't know that they can get it. They should contact District Health Department Number 2 directly as to the best means to get the containers.
Okay, because one of the documents in your packet here indicates that the containers with the proper credentials and so forth can be obtained at Rogers Foods. But a better thing would be to call District Health Number 2, and that's in Tawas City.
Just to be sure, yes.
Okay, thanks. Okay, and then, of course, the other two are the, Fleece and Vandenbrink Agreement execution. And one of our board members had some questions about the, the actual makeup ingredients, if you will, of the dust control, and we have been provided with that. So anybody have a question about any of these? Then I need a motion to adopt the consent agenda.
So moved. Second.
Okay, moved by Mr. Gajewski and supported by Mr. Cummings that we do agree with the consent agenda. Roll call, please.
Ms. Carrasco, yes. Mr. Cummings?
Yes.
Mr. Gajewski?
Yes.
Ms. McGuire?
Yes.
Mr. Beyer?
Yes. Okay, next we move on to Bob's action item reports. First item of six deals with the refuse collection that we, this will be the second year for us, right? The drop-off refuse collection. So.
Thank you. Yes, last year was our first year with Sunrise Disposal. We entered into a contract agreement which provides the ability to extend for up to 3 years. So that's one of the questions this evening is, do we want to renew based on discussion at the work session? I presume the answer there would be yes. We had talked at the work session about prospective dates towards the middle to latter part of the summer. I zeroed in on late July or early August, and the vendors indicated that after June 11th, they're quite flexible. So specifically, the dates of July 30th or August 6th appear to be in our target zone, if you will, given the work session discussion. And I presume we would proceed the same way we did last year in terms of just updating the flyer from 2015, which I've attached to my report, which shows the materials that would be collected, fact that it would take place at the Sunrise Disposal site, and the fact that a permit would need to be obtained for $10. So basically two questions here. Number one, do we want to go ahead and renew? If so, that would probably involve our attorney drafting a relatively brief extension agreement authorizing the supervisor and clerk to execute that. I could bring it back, but I would envision that being a pretty simple document. And then if we move ahead, number two, what is the preferred date, and do we want to use the same format? And that format, if you will, was kind of worked through with the vendor as to what they can and can't take, et cetera, at that location. So.
Okay. Any questions or discussion from the board?
Are we going to have the tire disposal thing or the grant to be able to do that again this year? No?
No, we didn't. Asabel Township didn't want to apply for one again this year.
You would like us to pick one of those dates?
I think we should consider August 6th because I believe the 30th is the Asabel Marathon, Marathon weekend.
Yeah. Okay, good. These when you selected these two dates, are they?
Last weekend in July.
Yeah, last full weekend.
Are they both like Fridays or what?
Or Saturdays.
They're Saturdays. Mm-hmm. Okay. I like the August 6th too, but not for reasons that are as noble as yours. Just personal, better for me. So, any other comment?
Bob, when did we have this last year? Do you remember?
It was on there.
I think it was closer into September.
I was going to say, I thought it was in the fall.
Yeah, because we didn't get it going right away.
We didn't talk about it early.
Right. So I
July
think it was
18th.
Yep.
Oh, was it?
Right on there.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
I figured it was right about the same time.
I thought it was. I didn't remember.
Is there anything we're doing different? Anything that we need to tweak from learning a lesson last year or anything?
No, as I understand it, it went fairly well. It went fairly well in terms of
I've had a few people ask about it already this year.
Have you?
Yeah, I've had people ask too.
You have some plans to really advertise this as we get closer? Okay.
We do. One of the benefits of doing it now is we can get it in the newsletter.
Yeah.
Like establishing a date and a direction.
Right. Okay. Well, I would make a motion we go for August 6th, but as I said, it's kind of selfish reasons. Convenient for me, and the 30th is not, so.
I'll support that.
Okay.
Are we going to do an extension on the agreement as a separate motion or combine?
Let's pick the day first.
Okay.
Okay. Roll call, please.
Mr. Gajewski?
Yes.
Ms. McGuire?
Yes.
Ms. Kraska, yes. Mr. Cummings?
Yes.
Mr. Byer?
Yes. Motion is carried. Now, the second item on this regard is a motion to extend the agreement with Sunrise Disposal as presented.
I'll move.
Okay.
Support.
Motion by Ms. McGuire with support from Mr. Gajewski. We do extend the agreement with Sunrise Disposal for a drop-off refuse collection, August 6th, 2016. Roll call, please.
Mr. Cummings?
Yes.
Mr. Gajewski?
Yes.
Ms. McGuire?
Yes.
Ms. Kraska, yes. Mr. Byer?
Yes. Motion carried. Next, item two is the State Street Square building sale process.
Yes, this item two is follow-up from our work session discussion. There appeared to be consensus that, number one, the township board would be amenable to considering selling the building, and that if we were going to proceed down that path, that soliciting bids on a competitive basis and allowing a 30-day time frame would make sense with a minimum bid of $220,000. So to provide perspective on that approach, I went back and looked at the ad that had been put together several years ago when the township sold property under similar circumstances, also on US 23. I've attached that ad from several years ago and provided an updated ad for your consideration that would be published with any changes if we proceed that the board felt were appropriate. So basically folks would be asked to respond no later than June 8th to express interest in this building with a minimum bid of $220,000.
And the previous sale of property you were referring to is where the Edward Jones building now stands, and we just sold the vacant property there, right?
There was a structure there as well, yes.
Refresh my memory here. Who did we demolish the structure of the gas station there, or did some other party? Or
I believe the DEQ was involved in that, but I'd have to go back and look at the file.
The DEQ removed the tanks and the canopies over the pumps. Sorry, I drew a blank. Yeah. But the building itself was done by the party that bought it.
I see. All right. Well, I would say further that we did get two appraisals regarding this building. State Street Square is where we are tonight. Our appraiser, Northern Appraising, Nancy Schwickert, I believe the figure was $250,000. And then we hired an outside firm. And the figure that the gentleman came up with was $282,500. So we are asking price that the, in a work session, we talked about this so a week ago or so. And it was the attended by, I believe, all seven board members at that time. Mm-hmm. And we talked about it quite extensively. And the figure $220,000 seemed to be the consensus figure. So, just a little background about where that comes from. And is that about right?
That's right.
Anybody else want to kick in here?
Yep.
Okay. Then we're going to need a motion to advertise for that minimum bid.
I'll make a motion that we publish and publicize the attached solicitation based on our potential sale of the State Street Squares building.
Second.
Okay. Motion by Ms. McGuire with support from Mr. Cummings. Okay. Anything further on that? Roll call, please.
Bob, do you want the, I'm sorry, do you want the bid amount being established in that motion also?
Well, it probably would be appropriate, although the ad is written with the bid amount included, so I leave that to your discretion.
If you include that in my motion, please,
yep,
Chris.
Will do.
Okay.
Thank you.
All right. Anything else? Roll call.
Ms. Carrasco, yes. Mr. Cummings?
Yes.
Ms. McGuire?
Yes.
Mr. Gajewski?
Yes.
Mr. Byer?
Yes. Okay, item three under Bob's report, fire department equipment, potential purchases.
Yes, I've attached a copy of our current capital improvement plan that was adopted with the fiscal year 2016 budget. And you may recall, based on discussion dating back to February of this year, that we had originally envisioned purchasing self-contained breathing apparatus as sort of our major purchase this year with the millage funding. But we had set aside the self-contained breathing apparatus purchase based on the premise that there was going to be a regional effort to secure grant funding that would offset a significant portion of that cost. So the idea was then, if we're not going to pursue that that particular equipment, maybe that'll create the opportunity to consider substituting a tanker truck, which had originally been budgeted, I believe, for 2018. Then, based on that premise, the fire department proceeded in soliciting bids. I had sent out a communication, I think, on Friday detailing those bids. And originally, the hope was, even though we had budgeted $200,000, the hope was that the bids had actually come in closer to the cost of the self-contained breathing apparatus. That did not happen, so we have a little bit of a budget overage from a conceptual standpoint. Specifically, after a great deal of work in winnowing down the cost and getting the appropriate piece of equipment specified for our community, the end number is $210,579.55 from the Truck Works Company. And I note that our fire chief and a fire lieutenant, captain, sorry, got demoted, are in the audience this evening. And in particular, Mr. Brown has spent a fair amount of time on this project. So they are here to answer questions you might have regarding the equipment. The basic question then is, do we have a means where we can make some modifications to the capital improvement plan that would allow the purchase to proceed? And one thought that we came up with was the potential for deferring. We had originally budgeted two installment purchase payments in the current year. We had purchased the 2013 Pierce on an installment purchase plan. And the concept we had talked about with the capital improvement plan is we'll double up the payments to save on interest cost. Well, if we were to set one of those aside this year and make one instead of two payments, that would give us the flexibility we would need to be able to free up cash and make the purchase of the tanker truck this year. It is possible preliminarily that we could make up that difference by making a third payment next year. That is somewhat of a question. The department heads are reviewing the capital improvement plan now. We go through an update process. So I wouldn't say that's a certainty, but based on the preliminary review, it's a possibility. So those are the questions. Do we want to consider purchasing the tanker truck? And if so, does the deferral of the installment purchase contract payment appear to make sense to the board in moving that purchase forward?
if you want to make extra payments, you don't have to make a full payment. You could make next year 2.5 payments or something like that.
We could, yes.
Right. And Mac, would you step up here?
Sure.
Good evening. Mr. McGregor, for the TV audience, and is our fire chief and also the sheriff. So, he wears two hats, but tonight he has none.
That's right.
I have a couple questions, but go ahead if you have things you want to say.
No, I really don't have anything to say. I gave it all to Bob. It kind of speaks for itself. There's been a lot of time and effort put in these specs, and the vehicle that we specced out is not a lot of frills on it. We specced out a truck that we feel is adequate for our community and the needs of our community based upon the money we have available to us. So I think we work with this company. It's a very reputable company. It's been in business forever. This is what they build is water tankers. They don't build actual fire trucks. They build water tankers. Mm-hmm. There's a big difference. So I think the specs that we developed and the bid that they put forward speaks for a very quality vehicle from them. It should meet the needs of our community very, very well.
How does the capacity compare to what we have now?
As far as gallons?
Yeah.
This one is a 3,500 gallon, and the one we have now is 2,000. We feel 35 is very adequate. You go much bigger than that, the vehicle gets to be bigger. It won't fit in the station. It won't get into areas where you really need to get it into. Mm-hmm. But if you have it too small, then it's not as useful. So 3,500 gallons is a good one for our area.
Where are we as far as the grant process for the other
for the SCBAs, the breathing apparatus? We'll know this fall. That's the only issue with that.
Yeah.
And if we're successful, it'll pay off the whole, I think it's close to just shy of $200,000 that we would have to pay through our millage. Mm-hmm. So it was worth waiting that year for.
Yeah.
It really was. I mean, if we're not successful, we're still in the game, but mm-hmm. If we are successful, it's going to save the township a lot of money.
Well, I personally have heard enough horror stories about the kind of the homemade tanker that we had, which has served us a number of years.
It served us well, but we needed it, and it's worked, but it's getting to the point where it's becoming unsafe. And,
yeah.
Yeah.
And what are we going to do with
that? There's some mechanical issues. Well, that would be a separate question. We haven't even got to that point with. I'm sure there'd be other fire departments that may want it, but you'd have to sell it as is with no liability attached to it. I mean,
I have this right that if you drive it over 25 miles an hour, something starts to jump all over the road on you.
It shakes a little bit. The suspension is not that great on it.
Yeah.
I mean, we appreciate DPW building that for us because we do need a outside water source for the areas where we don't have our hydrant system, but it becomes to the point of a safety issue. And, you know.
Right. Any prospect at all that you would want to keep it?
No.
No.
Okay. Captain Brown will not let me keep it. Somebody that knows quality knows we need to get rid of it.
Okay. Don't keep it. We were talking about this earlier today, and the question came up about how are you going to get delivery of this vehicle?
That's a different story. They'll deliver it, I believe, and Jack's talked to $4,500 to deliver it, or we can send somebody out and drive it back, one or the other.
Mm-hmm. How much to deliver?
$4,600.
I thought you said $46 for something. What a
it
deal.
Comes from Phoenix, Arizona. They'd have to flatbed it out here.
Yeah.
We can drive it on the road.
We can. I mean,
yeah.
Yeah. We can fly somebody out and have them drive it back.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, that's one of the downfalls. It's so far away, but this company's been in business for a long time, and they know what they're doing. They build water tankers.
How many in your request for bids? How many responses did you get?
We sent out 7 bids, and we received 5 back from different companies. and they ranged from all the way up to three, I think the highest was $335,000 to this one, which is at $210,000. So there's a wide range. Most of the high-end ones were people that built fire trucks.
I see.
And you get more frills on them just naturally.
And this one is built exactly according to our specs?
Yes.
Like the fire engine was, pretty much, wasn't it?
These pictures that I've given to Mr. Cummings are, they're actually the pictures, well, all of them actually, are as close to what we're going to get without it being built. This is a similar one that was built for another agency. We'll be able to pump water with it. We'll be able to dump water with it. It'll be a, you can actually use it as a backup fire truck to a certain degree.
It's impressive.
It is. It's a very impressive vehicle, and I think it'll sufficiently meet our needs.
It'll be a nice addition to the 4th of July parade.
I think it'll be here for the, maybe next year. There's a building period we have to go through.
That's what I was going to ask. How long?
I don't know. What did they finally say, Jack? Do you remember?
It's about 180 days out.
Well, 6 months.
The time they receive the deposit, that it goes through engineering, then the cab and chassis gets ordered. And they're looking at 6 to 7 weeks just to get the
chassis.
Cab and chassis. And then the rest of it is production. Get it into production, shake down.
When it arrives here, it's ready to put water in and go. It's going to have all the labeling, decaling on it for the township. They have a graphic design company that puts on what we...
You don't have to worry about labeling or nothing.
No. No.
Will that assist our trucks hooked up to the river to our truck over here?
Yes.
And keep up with the truck we got now?
Well, I don't think, what is it, 1,250?
1,250 gallon minute pump.
On the tanker. We have a 1,500 gallon minute pump on the truck.
So we can, I mean, we can operate.
It'll
like
be close. It'll okay. be close, which we've never had that ability to do that.
Exactly. Before. That's what I was getting at.
Right. We've never had the ability to do that before.
Captain Brown, how long did you stay up at night figuring all these specs out?
I've been dreaming on this for years. So when you got the nod to go ahead and do the bids, I pretty much had everything in my head.
I got to thank you and the fire department, because this spec is second to none, what I could see of it. I looked at it thoroughly.
Being a mechanic and a truck driver.
Jack's got a lot of experience in heavy equipment and trucks. And
I realize
that's why
that.
It fit really well into our
And I used to order them for a company I used to work for, so I know what you're going through. Great job. Good job.
Al, just out of curiosity, and since you got to kind of pick and choose your specs, what was the most important feature that you got to pick on this truck?
Safety. Okay. By far. I spec the suspension out so anybody could drive it, because we have people on the fire department that are truck drivers. So you have to be very conscious of how it's built and what you put into it to make it handle, make it stop, you know, have enough power to get out of harm's way or something, you know.
With the one we currently have, if you have any type of grade at all getting into a, and let's face it, this vehicle is used for off-road, for some degree off-road, woods fires is a big thing for it. If you get any type of grade at all, the one we have now doesn't have the power to get up that grade.
Yeah, it hardly makes it up River Road.
Yeah. So this is designed specifically for what we do, which has been a blessing for us, really.
Any consultation with Arizona at all on these specs, or are you just?
Yeah, they'll build anything we want.
Yeah, I figured that, but.
Yeah, we batted it back and forth for probably 3 weeks.
Okay.
Pretty much the way I spec'd it is what they would actually build. Mm-hmm. You know? So I wasn't that far out, you know, so as far as axles and stuff like that, it was pretty much cut and dry.
Okay.
And I don't think they're getting any cheaper. I mean, we've penny pinched them, this company, quite a bit in the last few weeks to get it down as low as we can. Next year it's just going to be more money. I truly believe that.
Right.
I'm not trying to put any pressure, but we've really worked them. We don't have a lot of frills on this. It's more necessity than anything. not a lot of bling to it, but it's exactly what we need for this community, for, to get it where we need to get it to.
All right, thank you.
Any other questions? Thank you.
No, thank you.
I make a motion that we go ahead with this purchase.
Support.
Okay.
Are you addressing the deferred payments in the same motion, or do you want that separately, or does it need to be in the motion?
Probably would be advisable to do it separately, just for clarity's sake.
Okay. Byron Cummings, got it. Any further questions or comments? Roll call, please.
Ms. McGuire?
Yes.
Mr. Gajewski?
Yes.
Ms. Prisco, yes. Mr. Cummings?
Yes.
Mr. Byer?
Yes. All right. Then you need a motion to what effect regarding the payment?
To defer the second payment for 2016, I think.
Okay.
I'll make a motion that we defer the second payment for 2016.
Okay.
Support.
Okay, motion by Ms. McGuire with support from Mr. Gajewski. Just a quick question. Approximately what, you know, the millage, the fire millage that was passed in the last year or so, how much does that generate per year?
About $285,000, right in that neck of the woods.
Okay. Pardon me?
If you would have asked me that earlier, I could have had the figure for you exactly.
Really? 285 is close enough. So. Okay, roll call, please.
Mr. Gajewski?
Yes.
Ms. McGuire?
Yes.
Mr. Cummings?
Yes.
Ms. Prisco, yes. Mr. Byer?
Yes. Motion carried. Item 4, Land Use Recreation Master Plan Survey.
Thank you.
Yes.
During our last meeting, we talked about the combined survey that was intended to solicit public input for updating the land use and recreation master plans. The discussion led to a question as to whether the survey in question, the one that had been put in the board packet, was the most updated version and included then current Planning Commission input. We've subsequently investigated from a staff standpoint and found out that, at least from our consultant standpoint, that was the current version, but there was also some question as to whether all Planning Commission input had been incorporated. So to remedy that, the survey was once again evaluated by the Planning Commission, in this case on May 2nd, and what resulted from that is a marked up copy with handwritten notes from our zoning administrator of the survey instrument, which is found in the board packet. So I think that's about as current as we're going to get for the time being. Mm-hmm. What Spicer is asking is that we incorporate input from the board at the same time, and on that basis then they can prepare a final survey instrument. I note that we had gotten some feedback from Trustee Weed at the last meeting, and that will be incorporated and forwarded on to them as well. So seeking a final review of an input of the survey from the board at this point. And I had suggested at the last meeting that if we were going to do an exhaustive review, you might consider creating a committee. Not that we need to, but if we're going to get into a lot of nuts and bolts in terms of the review process, that might be an appropriate step.
Okay. Bob, thank you for, you know, being our liaison with the Planning Commission on this, and I think it was your comment last time that said that, you know, is this really the right one or is this the current one? And I think we discovered that a Spicer person maybe didn't have it all.
Well, there was some questions.
There was some question.
Yes.
So. Anyway. Does anybody on the Planning Commission or here have an idea what would be a really good, meaningful response? How many responses? 100? 1,000? Anybody ever given that any thought? Okay.
Is it being sent to, who is it being sent to? Everybody? The whole?
There's going to be a media blitz, whether there'll be in the paper, there will be a website specifically, it'll say oscodasurvey.com. It'll be available both at your office, also at the library, I believe, and probably mentioned on the board.
Sign.
A sign out front, and any kind of newsletter or anything, anything that we can get out there.
Right.
And I'm not 100% sure, but I believe he said a 700 person response would be pretty good.
The Spicer guy said that?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I'm thinking the Oscoda's was somewhere similar to that. We're going to do better than that, I think. Now, one of the things with social media is they're going to advertise, and apparently there's a way on social media that they can have, put it on an ad on the site, and that'll reach approximately 7,000 people in our area. So that ad would reach, so that might be a good, tell them to go to the survey and on the.
So anybody can take the survey, they don't have to live here?
Pretty much.
Pretty much.
It's actually up now. I did it the other day.
Did you give all the right answers? Did you cheat?
Oscodasurvey.com.
Nice.
He took the old survey.
But I'll take it again.
Okay. Then feedback is all you need, and is that correct?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. I've expressed this before, I think it's a very valuable thing, but I sure don't want to make it any bigger. I mean, people, well, 9 pages now, you know, you reach a point of exhaustion. I don't even want to touch that, you know, so small print or something. So. Okay. All right, next item. Fireworks. It's getting to be that time of year. Fireworks license and permit.
It is. We had determined last year after the fireworks show was hosted at the Beach Park Pier that appeared to be a good venue. The show itself was well received in the community. So we essentially extended with Great Lakes Fireworks for another year. I put a copy of that extension document in the packet for your information. And because we're heading down that path again, we need to get consent from the property owner to the north through a license agreement, presumably, to allow us onto the property to erect the necessary safety perimeter zone and to be able to control the area and maintain that safety zone when the event takes place. So we put together, or I put together, a license agreement based on the format we used last year, sent it to the property owner. We actually, there are actually two property owners, received feedback indicating they both would sign. I actually have the license as of today with one signature, so we will get the second presumably in the next day or so. So that would be item one relative to this topic, is potentially authorizing the supervisor and clerk to execute that license. Item two is a permit form that comes from the State Department of Licensing and Regulatory Affairs. A designated legislative representative needs to execute that permit in order to move our fireworks show forward and for our vendor to get additional permits that are required to facilitate the show. They're asking for a response from us no later than May 15th. So the second item would be approval to execute that permit with the supervisor presumably being the designated legislative representative to sign.
Okay, is there any discussion regarding either one of these items? And of course, the permit from the nearby property owner is something you will take care of. We don't need to vote on that.
Well, actually, that would be a second part of this item, is authorization for the supervisor and clerk to sign that license. We've gotten the signed copy back from one of the property owners. I expect the second to be in the next few days, but.
Okay, all right.
Okay, so I make a motion, we authorize the supervisor and clerk to execute the license.
Support.
Okay. McGuire and Carrasco. Anything further on that? Roll call, please.
Ms. McGuire?
Yes.
Mr. Cummings?
Yes.
Mr. Guyaski?
Yes.
Ms. Carrasco, yes. Mr. Byer?
Yes. Second is the fireworks permit required by the state, and.
I'll make a motion, we authorize the supervisor to execute the permit.
Support.
Okay. That'd be McGuire and Guyaski. Anything further on that? Further discussion, questions, anything? Roll call, please.
Ms. McGuire?
Yes.
Mr. Cummings?
Yes.
Ms. Carrasco, yes. Mr. Guyaski?
Yeah.
Mr. Byer?
Yes. Okay, before we move on to something other than Fourth of July fireworks, I would like to issue a invitation to anybody in the room or anybody watching on TV or reading in the paper. It's become a custom. It is not a law or anything like that, but it has become a kind of a custom that the supervisor is the guy that kind of picks the parade marshal for the Fourth of July. And I've enjoyed doing that. Particularly proud of last year's, where we had a Marine colonel that, with many tours of duty in dangerous countries, and an Oscoda native. But there have been some others, Connie Coletta in 2007. But I'm a little drained of ideas, so. Anybody has any ideas that would make a good parade marshal here in Oscoda, don't hesitate to give me a call or something like that. I'm open for ideas, so.
Good.
Anyway, with that, we'll move on to item six, the letter of our understanding with our employees.
Yes. And this is kind of a combination item with one of the resolutions, which is was included in the packet when I put my report together. It was being under review from a legal standpoint, but it is included in the packet. And basically, what the letter of understanding that's attached to my report does is holds harmless. It's three employees, not four, who are representative by the Oscoda Township Employees Union if the resolution is adopted, which basically says that regular part-time employees cannot be scheduled or should not be scheduled more than 29 hours per work week. And this is intended to ensure we're complying with guidelines established in the Affordable Care Act. So we have three employees that would be affected, and essentially we would take their current wage on a 30-hour schedule and do the math for each one of them and hold them harmless, and therefore their hourly rate would go up based on the 29-hour schedule. And what it amounts to totally annually is about $2,300. It's about a 3.3% increase for those three employees. The bargaining unit at this point has approved letter of understanding, and I'm seeking authorization for the supervisor and clerk to execute it as well. And again, it is kind of a companion document and intended to be consistent with the resolution. So if there were any reservations or concerns about the resolution, we should probably talk about those prior to acting on this item. Basically, the resolution establishes that 29-hour work week for part-time regular employees, and also establishes a 9-month limitation on employment for seasonal employees determined on a calendar year. Again, same kind of thing to try and establish some limitations on the number of hours worked so that we're in compliance with those ACA guidelines.
Okay. Well, you've all had an opportunity to look at, we have two resolutions on our agenda tonight. Do any of you have a question about the one that deals with our topic presently? Seem okay? All right. Then if everybody's happy with that, then let's go ahead with the letter of understanding that authorizes myself and the clerk to sign. So I need a motion to that effect.
I'll make a motion that we approve the letter of understanding and authorize the supervisor and clerk to execute the same.
Support.
Okay, motion by Ms. McGuire with support from Mr. Cummings that we do go ahead with the letter of understanding with the Oscoda employees that are affected by this. So. Well, actually, the whole group. Okay, roll call.
Ms. Carrasco, yes. Mr. Cummings?
Yes.
Mr. Gajewski?
Yes.
Ms. McGuire?
Yes.
Mr. Barr?
Yes. All right. Next, we move on to the community development coordinator, and Ann has a topic, an action topic regarding the DNR trust fund grant.
Okay, thank you. At the April 25th meeting, the board was provided an update in regard to notification from the grant agency that the funds had been approved and allocated by the governor for the recommended 2015 round of Michigan Natural Resources Trust Fund projects. The board granted approval to execute the grant agreement document as presented and adopted resolution 2016-09, confirming the township's commitment of the local share for the acquisition of the property. As part of the due diligence requirement before signing the agreement document, two components have been completed. A 40-year title search was ordered and completed by Landmark Title, and Sagacer and Associates have completed a record search and risk assessment and have determined that the subject property is not considered a facility. As previously mentioned, there's a June 5th deadline for submission of the grant agreement itself. This evening, staff is seeking approval to move forward with the process of securing a market value of the property by a certified general appraiser. As the cost of this appraisal is undetermined at this time, staff is seeking board approval to possibly exceed the $2,000 authorization limit that the purchasing policy allows staff to spend if it's necessary.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Any discussion?
So we have a list of about 56 appraisers that are have provided certified appraisals for the grant agency that we can solicit proposals from. It's pretty specific in the grant agreement that says you can get an appraisal from from somebody who has done a certified appraisal in the past, but that doesn't necessarily mean that your appraisal will be accepted. But you're supposed to follow the certain guidelines, and chances are if you go with one that has done an appraisal for the grant agency before, you know, they should know the guidelines, but it is quite a few guidelines that they have to follow.
Okay.
Since we know that it's going to cost more than the $2,000 you mentioned, do we have a ballpark figure?
I really do not. I mean, I'm guessing it would be more based on just the recent appraisals that we've gotten, like for instance, this building.
Ah,
so I'm thinking with, we haven't actually, we're soliciting cost proposals for, actually we do have one. I can't remember what it came in at for the, or size and Schmidt is, it was a $1,500 or $1,800 for that, and that is a commercial building as well.
I see.
Wouldn't it be a little less because it's empty lot, or not really?
I'm thinking with all the guidelines, mm-hmm. Jamie, that's mandatory from the state, that it's probably more, a little bit more involved in the reports. But I'm just guessing. I mean, I'm not gonna shoot for a higher dollar figure, but just one.
right.
Just in case it does go over that, just to not
stop
the process.
We have to have it, so it's,
right.
I would suggest a not to exceed agreement here, something where we could pick a number that can give you the latitude to get the appraisal, but still provides a limit.
Yeah.
It wouldn't be a...
$3,000?
Yeah, something like that's fine.
I'd go higher than that.
I mean, if we don't know what the limit is.
What's the timeline? We have to have this in by... We have to have this back to the state by a certain...
Not necessarily by a certain time do we have to have this. The grant agreement itself is due by June 5th, but the appraisal cannot be started until the grant agreement is signed and turned in.
Okay.
So...
So we have some latitude here.
We have some latitude, but we have, you know, the property owners are, have been obviously in the wings for a while now and are anxiously waiting the appraisal because there's a step review process with that as well.
Right.
Do you think, what do you think, Ann, to put a limit on it if we wanted to do that?
I can't imagine. I mean, Bob, have you done one in the past? I mean, I can't think it'd be more than 5,000, but...
I would say go to five.
But, yeah.
Because you don't want to have to have it come back to the board and go, oh, by the way.
That's right. Yeah, that's just waste of time.
Yeah, I can't imagine it could be more than that. If it is, I'm in the wrong line of work. That could be a whole nother meeting. Yeah, let's not go there.
Hard left turn there.
Yeah, right.
Okay. So you're gonna contact multiple?
Well, just like, we'll probably, I would assume the farther you get out, the more it's gonna cost because they're gonna have to travel and so on. But we could actually send everybody on the list, request for a proposal and see where they come in. Because they're all over the state. The closest one is actually in Tawas, but they're all over.
Everybody agree at five?
I'm good with 5,000.
Okay. I need a motion then to come up with such a proposal.
I make a motion to approve the exceeded amount of $2,000, but not to exceed $5,000.
Support. Okay. A roll call when ready.
Mr. Gajewski?
Yes.
Ms. McGuire?
Yes.
Ms. Prasco, yes. Mr. Cummings?
Yes.
Mr. Beyer?
Yes. Okay. Ordinances and resolutions. The first one we have is the year 2016, and this will be number 11 resolution of this calendar year. So 2016-11. Robert?
Yes, this resolution deals with compliance with Public Act 152, which is the public act that was adopted in 2011 and intended to allow municipalities to provide some tools in controlling health care costs. And there are three options which we are asked by the state to identify, one of which we're going to subscribe to for the medical care coverage year. Those are the hard cap, the 80-20 cost sharing model, or opting out. Our current collective bargaining agreements make reference to the hard cap, but we are in negotiation currently. Frankly, would expect that the hard cap approach will not change, but the resolution as drafted would authorize opting out to give us flexibility should we change our approach as compared to past years. So, and I should note also that based on the projected cost increase for June 1st, under the hard cap, actually the employees would not be paying. So it's not a meaningless act, but there's not a significant issue here with the hard cap based on the renewal estimate. So again, if adopted, we would be electing to opt out for the medical plan year June 1, 2016 through May 31, 2017.
Anybody see any downside to this? Okay.
I'll make a motion that we approve resolution 2016-11.
Support.
Okay. And you have all three options printed in the verbiage here. You need a statement saying the opt-out is the choice?
I believe it is specified in the last paragraph there.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes. Okay. All right. Anything else? Roll call, please.
Mr. Cummings?
Yes.
Mr. Gajewski?
Yes.
Ms. McGuire?
Yes.
Ms. Carrasco, yes. Mr. Byer?
Yes. Next, we move to Resolution 2016-12.
This is the resolution we spoke about just a few minutes ago that would establish the 29-hour limitation on regular part-time schedules for employees, and also 9 months worked in a calendar year by seasonal employees.
Okay. As Bob mentioned, we have discussed this. We have listened to his ideas on this. So I need a motion. I will make the motion that we do adopt the resolution number 2016-12.
Support.
Okay. Further discussion? Roll call, please.
Ms. Carrasco, yes. Mr. Cummings?
Yes.
Ms. McGuire?
Yes.
Mr. Gajewski?
Yes.
Mr. Byer?
Yes. Okay, we move on to other, and the first item under other is Little League operating agreement.
Yes, we're a couple of weeks late here, frankly. They've started the season, but the Little League operating agreement is an annual event wherein we talk to the group about the services the township will provide, spell out the services that the Little League would provide. They provide us with an insurance certificate, and we essentially commit for the time frame specified to make the fields available. And in this case, it's April 15 through July 1st. I note that their officers have executed the agreement and am seeking authority for the supervisor and clerk to execute it on the township's behalf.
Okay. Well, this is kind of a no-brainer, I think, a little bit, especially since the season has already started. So I would make the motion that we go ahead with this agreement with the Little League organization.
Support.
Okay. Byer and McGuire. Any further comments? Roll call.
Ms. McGuire?
Yes.
Mr. Gajewski?
Yes.
Ms. Carrasco, yes. Mr. Cummings?
Yes.
Mr. Byer?
Yes. Motion carried. Number two, Munitrix contract agreement.
So we had talked about this at a work session and then followed up. I believe Mr. Cummings reported on it at the last meeting. And the idea, as I understood it, was to bring this back for consideration and potential action. This being the Munitrix financial planning and data presentation software, there is a contract, which I should indicate has not been subjected to legal review. It's given the $2,400 cost that gets into question whether that's a necessary step, but I should point that out specifically. The benefit, like we have talked, is the program allows us to make financial information available to the community on a regular basis. It enhances transparency. It allows us to compare ourselves to other communities for purposes of measuring essentially how we stack up in terms of strengths and weaknesses. It allows us to pull together the Citizens Guide to Finances, which is the revenue sharing component that's fairly labor intensive now, on a much more efficient basis. And one thing I might add, in addition to all the subscription elements that they identify there under the pricing options, it will undoubtedly be very helpful in putting together the 5-year plan we talked about at the work session. In our goal statement, you might recall, we talked about adding a financial plan over 5 years, similar to what we do with capital improvement plan. So I would envision this being helpful in that regard. It's a year-to-year scenario, as I understand it. If we don't pay when we're invoiced, the service is terminated. So if we don't find it to be of value, we can certainly reconsider at some point in the future. The annual cost is $2,400. I think that's a reduction as compared to the initial quote. I know it's a reduction. I think it was $3,000. So essentially, we are looking for authorization, or I am, to execute the contract agreement if the board would like to proceed in taking advantage of this software package.
Bob, does that include support, the $2,400, or is that a different thing like we have with our software with BSNA?
I believe it includes the support, yes.
So could, like, if they send us the invoice and we don't want to pay it, would we keep the software package that we have and it just wouldn't get updated, that type of thing? We could continue to use it, or we would?
I think it would go away at that point.
Okay.
Yeah. You are subscribing to their service, so to speak.
Okay. So you upload the stuff to them and they put it together for you then?
Well, they have a software package you can access to do the comparative analysis.
Okay.
So you would just plug in the numbers that mm-hmm. it asks
okay.
for?
Right.
And use their software thing for it?
Yeah, the service is in the cloud. It's an internet service, so
okay.
it's nothing you have to load on your computer.
All right. Do we have a motion?
I'll make the motion that we go forward with the Munitrex contract agreement.
Support.
Okay. Moved by Ms. McGuire with support from Mr. Cummings. Roll call, please.
Mr. Gajewski.
Yes.
Ms. McGuire.
Yes.
Mr. Cummings.
Yes.
Ms. Carrasco. Yes. Mr. Byer.
Yes. Item three, under other, Osceola Chamber of Commerce kickball tournament at the sports complex.
Yes. The chamber has asked to have access to the sports complex ball fields on June 18th to host a kickball tournament that would benefit the Shannon Shoeboxes program. They've indicated that they would provide an insurance certificate, and we have confirmed that there would not be a conflict with the Little League activities on that day. So approval is being sought to honor that request.
Will we have to have one of the seasonal workers out there because they want to have the restrooms open so we can maintain that, or just have them put that in their routine for the day, that day, to check it?
That we presumably would have folks on duty that day, so yeah, we would
okay.
have to make sure that they're
kind of like we do for Art on the Beach and stuff like that, to check that stuff.
We would have seasonal folks during the weekend and any this time of year in any event.
Will they be using the concession stand that we have there then in that building as well? Because it's asking for like setup of a food vendor on site, but don't we have a concession stand in that building where the restrooms are?
I don't believe they're going to use the concession stand,
okay,
but I can get clarification on that.
So it might be like a food truck or something that comes.
Right.
I think it's a great idea. It's kind of exciting.
Okay. Well, then let's go ahead. I need a motion to let this. This is the first time for this, right? This activity to go forward.
Yes. At least at this location.
Right.
Can I make a motion that we allow them to use the sports complex on June 18th for Shannon's Shoebox program?
Okay.
For the kickball tournament.
Support. Roll call.
Ms. McGuire?
Yes.
Ms. Carrasco? Yes. Mr. Cummings?
Yes.
Mr. Gajewski?
Yes.
Mr. Byer?
Yes. Okay, now we go to the additions to other, and I think I indicated number four would be just today, if I have this right, we received a invoice from the Gilbert Drugstore family indicating, I think you all have remembered this, that if we wish to extend our lease of the parking lot, use of the parking lot for an additional 3 months, the price would be the same as it was the first 3 months. $1,650, which is, so do we have any thoughts on that?
Should be noted that the current parking lot agreement in the first paragraph does provide the ability to extend upon mutual agreement of the parties.
Any ideas?
Has there been any issues in this last 3 months from anybody regarding the parking lot?
Not that I'm aware of.
Seems to me there are several options that are available to us. Say yes to this, say no to this, talk to our tenant first to see what, you know, out of courtesy of the tenant, what they think. Negotiate for a different number. You know, lots of ways to go. Anybody have some option that I haven't listed or dislikes or likes one of the things? So.
Well, I did like to see it. It was nice to get this. Mm-hmm. I thought that was nice.
My only concern is I have two elections that are going to fall in this time frame, and this is the location where we have one of our precincts. That's my only concern. Mm.
Do you feel that for people wanting to exercise their right to vote, that it's our responsibility to pay for that?
Well, not necessarily that, and I can't imagine that they'd have a tow truck out there getting ready to tow voters away. I can only imagine what the reaction to that might be. Mm-hmm. So,
would this cover both of the elections coming up, or just one?
Just one. It would if it goes through August 9th, it would cover both of them.
Hmm. What do we have coming up? Do we have the primary?
No, just the first one. I'm sorry, the August one. The November one wouldn't cover. No, right. I'm sorry. Okay. I misspoke on that.
All right. Oh, if they maybe slipped a school election.
No, don't even go there.
All right.
Got enough.
Well, again.
Oh, I'm sorry. I know what it was. We have a meeting that's over here on May 24th with all the election workers. That's what I'm thinking.
That's
of, not the election.
That was your second.
Yeah, that was the second one, not the election.
Well, we received this today, right? And mm-hmm. today happens to be the day that the first 3 months expires on May 9th. So we have zero room to. Any thoughts? Well, I'm going to try to break the ice here. I think, you know, even though it expires today, I think we should table this for until the next meeting and talk to our tenant. I think just common courtesy to talk to the tenant about what their thoughts about this are, and then
is talk that a about motion? It.
Yeah, I'd like to make that a motion.
I'll support that.
Okay. And if that's not acceptable, oh well. So. Okay, roll call, please.
Ms. McGuire?
Yes.
Mr. Cummings?
Yes.
Mr. Gajewski?
Yes.
Ms. Carrasco? Yes. Mr. Byers?
Yes. Okay, motion is carried. All right, number five, I mentioned a resignation. Once again, this is a last minute deal, just like the communication from the Gilbert family. I received this afternoon. With your indulgence, I would read it to you. Addressed to me. Dear Jim and fellow board members, it is with deep regret that I must resign my position as trustee of Oscoda Township. My work and travel commitments have changed greatly in the past 4 months. These commitments are such that I am unable to fill the requirements of my position on the board. This is a strong and effective board that is moving forward successfully. I do not want my time constraints to hinder its success in any way. I wish this board and the future board much success in its endeavors. Sincerely, Stephen J. Worsterbarth. I think most of us here know that when Steve first jumped forward to fill the seat of Mr. Matt Hinckley, he had a different job and same basic area, automobile parts, as I understand it. But then he changed jobs with a different firm to a different firm, and the picture has changed quite a bit.
Yeah.
And obviously, I haven't talked to him about this. This was quite a surprise to me, but I'm guessing he doesn't see a way to unravel the increased commitments. So,
yeah.
I need a motion to accept this. Or not accept him.
I'll make a motion that we accept his resignation and that I appreciate his time on the board.
Mm-hmm.
I'll support that.
Okay. Ms. McGuire with support from Mr. Gajewski. Appreciate his time and input. Roughly, Steve started with us, the latter part of last year?
Late summer, maybe.
Okay.
Yeah, I believe.
Okay. Well, all right. Roll call.
Ms. McGuire?
Yes.
Mr. Cummings?
Yes.
Ms. Krasko, yes. Mr. Gajewski?
Yes.
Mr. Beyer?
Yes.
Jim, do we try to refill this position between now and November?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Yes.
Right.
I called the MTA today in the afternoon. Again, this hit me in mid-afternoon. And I asked them, do we have to advertise, go through the whole deal, lay this out for a couple weeks, or can we just pick somebody that we, are agreed upon?
Mm-hmm.
And she said, yeah, you can pick somebody. You don't have to go through the big process of soliciting candidates. We did that twice. But if you want to pick, if you've got one person in mind, that's fine. So, in that regard, I would say, again, one guy's opinion here.
Mm-hmm.
Mr. Bill Palmer, who is in attendance here tonight and is mm-hmm. in attendance every meeting in recent past, and has put his name forward twice in as far as filling of trustee openings. And thirdly, the attendance and the two times putting his name forward only to have someone else, selected. But he also has proven his interest in this by submitting his name for the oncoming primary and general elections. But if you want to go through the process that we have two times before, that's up to you guys.
I make a motion. We accept William Palmer as our new trustee.
I support.
I don't have anything about that because he is here every time. Mm-hmm. I guess my only feeling about it is because he has already got a petition to run for office that maybe this would encourage somebody that was considering running for office to put their name in to kind of get their feet wet to see if they're interested in it. And then when the election comes, if they wanted to run, they could. If not, then obviously Mr. Palmer, at this point, everybody's pretty much unopposed, would automatically get a seat at the table. Mm. But that would be my only thing.
That has,
I don't care either way. But
yeah, but no, that's has some validity to
right.
it.
Right. I mean, just to encourage people to go, hey, here's an opportunity to get up there and see. Mm-hmm. But
those people have had two opportunities to,
Plus the opportunity of getting a petition and nobody got one.
Right, right.
True, but just throwing that out.
We advertised it after every meeting.
That's fine, I think that's good thinking, but I'm kind of in favor of getting a full board as quickly as we can, you know, and so we have support on that in the motion. Any other thoughts?
I'll give my support again, although it was interrupted, so, because she wanted to speak some further, so, thank you.
Any other thoughts? Then roll call, please.
Mr. Asko, yes. Mr. Cummings?
Yes.
Mr. Gajewski?
Yes.
Ms. McGuire?
Yeah.
Mr. Byer?
Yes. Okay. Now, it's been brought to my attention, I was thinking of maybe doing this early, but it was brought to my attention, he has to be sworn in before he can set up here.
That's right.
So, welcome to the board, Bill, and at your earliest convenience, you need to go see this lady at her office during working hours, and she will take care of the legalities, and we'll see you in 2 weeks.
I won't be there in the morning because I have to take my car in, but Jessica will be there in case you have free in the morning, but I'll be there in the afternoon. Okay, so Jessica can swear you in if I'm not there.
Be sitting at the door, 7:30. Okay.
That creates another problem.
Yes.
Planning Commission.
Two on the Planning Commission.
Oh, boy.
So I have to appoint one for the Planning Commission.
In the future, in the near future, not tonight.
Near future.
Yeah, all right.
He hasn't been sworn in yet.
Right.
Remember that.
Okay, no, thank you for bringing that to my attention. All right. Okay. Thank you for being willing to do this, so.
Thank you.
All right, number six item, road item. I don't need any action on this, but I did attend a meeting at the Iosco County Road Commission this morning, 10 o'clock, at their offices out on M-55, along with a modest-sized delegation from people that live in the Alexander Road area. Some lived on Alexander Road, some lived in feeder lines that go to it. And it's a particularly complicated paving deal because if you're familiar with it, the first, let's say, 1,000 feet, roughly, go through state forest land. Large trees on both sides. The state is not going to participate in any of our special assessments. And that, in my estimation, is the worst part of the road because the trees shield it from the sun, it doesn't dry out, the water lays there forever, and so it's really bad. But but to pave that, there would be no residential participation. The usual formula is 30%, that's cast in iron, 30% for the county. They will not pay any more. They don't dare pay any more. All the other roads that they contributed to would be screaming. Why not us, 32% or something like that? So, and then, of course, that leaves 70%, which would be pretty much our obligation to, you know, quite a few people that live down there. And a lot of those people pay the high dollar on lake frontage and so forth. And then once you get out of the state forest, the idea that was bandied about this morning, then it would be up to the residents to participate. However, a lot of the people that are interested do not live on Alexander, and but we have had a arrangement before, some years ago, where people that had feeder roads off the main road were able to contribute to the cost of paving the main road, Alvin Road to be exact, up off Bissonnette. Maybe we could research how we did that, you know. I guess tonight I urge you to go look at the road and just see what we're dealing with. You'll notice tire tracks on the shoulder where people are so afraid of the road that they drive on the shoulder. I understand there was a car went in the ditch recently since our meeting.
I had that same email.
Yeah. Just lost, there's no traction, it's just crumbles, you know. And wow. But I must caution you, and then I'll shut up about this, is that I got the sense that the road commission, you know, seal coat, which they usually are against, they would go for it. But they want in the contract a statement from Oscoda Township that some years down the line, they talked about 5 to 7 years, maybe more, they said, that we would pony up for money to reseal the seal coat, to preserve it and give it a longer life. They don't want to invest their 30% money and see it fall apart, because they're convinced that it won't last that much. Seal coat is a minor surfacing compared to full asphalt, mm-hmm. you know, so, but much less expensive, so.
Jim, does the, oh, go ahead.
No, go ahead, sorry.
Does the county plan on turning Alexander back to a gravel road?
They offered that. They did offer. They don't have a plan to do that, but they did say, though particularly one member of the 3-member board said, we are tired of putting patches on that, the coal patch, a patch upon patch, and it's just a waste of money in their mind.
Do they have a plan for turning any of our roads back to gravel?
Well, if they are not going to patch it anymore, or sometime in the future, then they turn it back. And the people there do not really care for that.
Right.
So, anyway, it's not something we have to decide for tonight, but I would urge you to take a drive out there. The first road you'll see is Coal Bath. That's worth looking at also.
That's good
very,
to say.
Very similar, very, very similar. And Alexander's a little further out toward, you know. They're both on your right as you're driving out before the big curve that heads into farm country, and so.
Hasn't the group from Coal Bath Road, from the residents down there, come to the,
mm-hmm.
okay.
Mm-hmm.
What's the status of that road?
Nothing that I can say. I mean, maybe if we can get something concrete done on Alexander. Most people agree Alexander's a little tougher shape. And we can get something there, then maybe we can find our way to,
were the I thought the people on Coal Bath were trying to get a petition or something.
There was talk of that,
okay,
but I haven't heard of it anything
okay.
yet.
All right.
But yes, they did appear.
I was going to say, I thought they did.
They definitely did. Yep. So, two pretty bad roads. So, please take a look. All right, that's the end of the additions to other, and we're back to public comment again. Four-minute deal. Yes, Bob.
Robert Tadger, Hillcrest Drive. In approximately 7 months, the police issue is going to come back and rear its head to us,
mm-hmm.
about the 24-hour service. Something has to be done about funding our police department. And I was wondering how the work's going about resolving that issue. I really haven't heard anything, and man, I just don't like to see that happen like it did last year. Last minute, we don't have, we're talking about 24-hour coverage and all losing officers, and it was stated this year that for 1 year, we're gonna continue it. Well, 7 months away, I was just wondering what was going on with that.
Well, I don't think I've got anything really specific to tell you, but I know I was talking with another board member here a couple of weeks ago, so it's on people's minds,
mm-hmm.
but as far as some program, we should.
I know there was talk about working with the prosecutor about getting some ordinance change to have some revenue brought in. I don't know if anything happened with that.
Not yet, Bob.
Okay.
Okay.
That's it?
Yeah. Thank you.
Hmm.
Also, in addition to that, maybe, you know, a combination with that, we should get together with the chief of police regarding the canoe rental issue that we've had.
Mm-hmm. Right.
It's coming up. All right. Anybody else? Okay. Board comment? Anybody? All right, then next thing is we have a closed session to consider collective bargaining strategy. So we're going to need to go into closed session, and thank you for coming.
I'll make a motion, we go into closed session.
Okay. Motion by Ms. McGuire, Ms. Court, Mr. Gajewski. Roll call, please.
Mr. Cummings?
Yes.
Mr. Gajewski?
Yes.
Ms. McGuire?
Yes.
Ms. Grasso? Yes. Mr. Meyer?
Yes.
Okay, almost forgot to answer it my own name.